All right, what a do, DMV. We officially thank you for tuning in throughout these playoffs. This will be our last show of the season. Caps just go down 4-0 in game 5. Just an abysmal performance. I guess I'll start with this. Congrats to the Islanders, man. They're a really good fucking team. Yeah. I'm not going to sit here and just be like, yo, the reason they won that series is because they outcoached us, which is a big part of it, but that's a really good team. That's a very deep team. They ran 4 lines the entire team. They got great goaltending out of Varlamov. And they don't got the superstars outside of, like, Barzal, but they're a deep team. They'll grind you out. They'll take you down. And, yeah, there it is. We're watching the handshakes right now. I was kind of hoping Barry Trotz would walk by. When he shook Todd's hand, he gives him a little tap on the nuts, being like, gotcha, bitch. Just quick in and out. So, AB's drinking beer. So, KP, let's start with you on this one, man. I mean, how you feeling? Game 5, last show of the season.
I mean, no desperation. Nobody wanted it. I mean, I feel bad for Holtby because I felt like he kept us in it. All the way to the last second, up to the third, I felt like we were in it. We had a chance, just one goal away, get some momentum. Yeah. So I don't know. Fuck this team. Fuck Todd Reardon.
So yeah, this is an off season where we hope we see some big changes. Obviously, there's not a lot to be talked about quite yet in terms of the office talking to the players themselves and figuring it out. They're going to take some time. They're going to get back from the bubble. But AB, the bubble, we're done. We're out 5 games. We got that slimmer of hope just to get shut out. And I'm thinking at that point, just fucking sweep me, man. Don't give me a little bit of hope and then shut me out. Like, come on.
Yeah, it's like we see the team for about 40 minutes of hockey that
we
needed, basically, right? Like,
yeah,
this is the team that we saw from October to the end of December.
Yeah.
They controlled and dominated play in a time where they were in an elimination game. They were down to nothing. And they finally showed a little bit of life. And it was like, it gave all of us a little bit of hope, right? It's just like, all right, cool. Like, this is, maybe they found their game. And it's just inconsistent. Like, it was, that's how it was all season long. We saw spurts. I'm not going to lie to you. We saw spurts of it, even though it was so bad from January to March. We did see spurts of that too. Like, against that Penguins game, we were like, oh shit, are we back? And then the very next game, we lost to, like, the Buffalo Sabres or something. Like,
right.
This was the team that we were that showed up to these playoffs. That was the team that we were in the regular season. It's plain and simple. There's no, like, we can't say we're better than this at this point. We weren't better than that. This is the team that we were. And Kyle keeps saying we were in every game. We were in every game. Yeah, we were in every game. Like, it's
– Score-wise.
Score-wise, we were in every game. But, like, dude, we just – the same issues came up. That the same issues in the playoff came up that were the same ones in the regular season. That's just the team we were.
Yeah, I mean, just a quick stat, real quick. Dmitry Filipovich, the New York Islanders gave up just 3 goals and 24 high danger attempts against at 5v5 in the entire series. So this is 2 years in a row of getting dumped in the first round. It's, you know, we win the cup, we make the change in the offseason to not bring Barry Trotz back. Because we're grooming Todd Reardon. Okay. So, you know, we go to game 7 against the Hurricanes last year. And then I go back and listen to the podcast. I don't give a shit. That's right when we started the show, really. And we got out. We went to game 7, but we got outplayed in, what, 5.5 games that series?
We got out coached the entire, every single game.
Yep. By Rod Brendamore. You saw it. And then this year.
Who I think was also a rookie head coach, Rod Brendamore.
Yeah.
And so his first year head coaching.
And now it's bounced in 5 games. Should have been a sweep. I mean, what are some offseason moves you would do, AB? You got to think something's got to be done by GMBM. And I don't think he reads Cap's Twitter, but it's got to be more than obvious that the number one issue is coaching and Todd Reardon. Am I wrong?
1,000%, dude. I mean, he made no changes. He didn't make a single goddamn change on offense, and we didn't score a goal. We didn't have one game. We had only one game where we scored more than two goals.
Yeah.
And he didn't make a single goddamn change on offense. Yeah, he rotated one fucking player. He scratched Travis Boyd, who honestly was one of their better guys.
Yeah, and then, in the night.
And he didn't play again tonight. But I mean, Backstrom came back, so I don't want to say enjoyed. I thought the creativity of Basham on the third line wasn't a terrible idea to get Kovalchuk going, but again, doesn't stick with it.
But trying to get Kovalchuk going at that point is such a fucking reach, man. Yeah, like, it's such a reach. That's such desperation. If I want anybody going, I really don't want Kovalchuk going. If I'm really trying to activate a scorer and somebody in this fucking lineup to get a goal outside of Ovi or Kuznetsov or Oshie in that first game, I'm trying to put Basham like Vrana or Wilson. Yeah. Or try to get Oshie goals 5-on-5 that aren't two fucking power play goals.
Yeah. I mean, it also could have been he wanted to see how Backstrom looked.
Right.
Looked in the first.
For two periods?
From there. But no, yeah, I understand later on. But I'm saying to start the game, maybe that was the decision going in.
Yeah, I mean.
But no, I agree. He needs to make a change. Into the third period, you're down 2-0. You haven't had a lot of good scoring chances. You need to change something up. You need to create offense somehow.
Yeah, and like it's so ridiculous that it takes him to be down in an elimination game, down 3-0 in a series, 3-1 in a series, down 2-0 in both games for him to make changes. That's when you want to make changes. Like, oh shit, maybe I'm coaching for my job right now. Maybe I should change something up. Like, what a fucking dumbass. Like, dude, be proactive. You're being reactive right now. Like, it's ridiculous, man. It's so stupid. Like, at least make a change when the series is 2-0, right?
Yeah, not third period down 2-0 in game 5, and it's like, now let's do something. Because we saw 8-19-77 together again right at the end of the fucking second period, but then just like we said it would on Twitter, right back to normal.
Switch back, and then they switched it for the third permanently, but I didn't even see them out in the ice that often, honestly. Like, well, like the first 10 minutes kind of zoomed by. The last 10 minutes they were out there, they were double shifting shifts and shifting lines and stuff like that. But I mean, obviously, it was kind of like Barry Trotz fucking set up his system. I mean, we keep ragging on the Caps. And if any Islanders fans are watching this right now,
we're not making excuses. You've been in our comments on YouTube and shit all post game show series.
You guys you out coached us, you outplayed us, you out hustled us. The Islanders were the better team.
You're a better team. You're going to be a better team. You're a younger team. You're a hungrier team. You're a well-coached team. And we're just getting too old at this point, I think.
They won the neutral zone every single game.
They won every zone. Oh, yeah. Fuck.
They won every
zone. The neutral zone was the biggest, though, because we couldn't create any offense because of how they clogged up the neutral zone. We're not a dump and chase team. We're making stupid passes at the blue line. I mean,
that game was a picture-perfect Barry Trotz game.
Yeah.
Sucked the life out of that third period, man. No fun was going to be had.
And he gets the shutout, and that's all Barry Trotz preaches is fucking team defense. They get their shutout. They had a 2-0 lead. They got a 2-0 lead pretty early. Once they get that 2-0 lead, they shut down the neutral zone, like Kyle was saying. We have no fucking opportunity. We did have a couple scoring opportunities, but not many. And then you score two empty netters, it's a 4-0 win, and it looks like a blowout, and it really felt like a blowout.
Yeah, for sure. So let's get to the goals here in a minute. Let's give two kind of shout-outs real quick. The first one being that it was kind of depressing watching Holpe's last game as a Capital.
Yes.
We'll break that down later in the later part of the show. But secondly, Rob Carlin, NBCSN, NBC Sports Washington, last show. He's done there. But so shout out to him, a real OG dude. That guy's a fucking legend. Love watching him. So yeah, shout out to him.
Yeah, hopefully land somewhere nice, man. We can keep getting content from him.
Come to chirping, baby.
DMV. So boys, well, this was supposed to be a kind of a crowded show. We were supposed to bring the Bobcat, the re-emergence of the Bobcat. Bobcat usually sits in when AB or KP or somebody's missing, but we're gonna have a 5-man show tonight, and I'm kind of devastated about it because we're gonna bring him in right now.
Thank you.
But unfortunately, we can't because he's called up doing laundry at his girlfriend's house or something. So fucking chirp him for all that all you want. But yeah, let's pour one out for the homie Hopi. That's for you, Bobcat, because AB really wanted to rip it around with you. So let's get into some of these goals, man. And we're only going to talk about two of them, obviously, because two of them are empty netters. What was the first one? The power play goal? Yeah, Bevilier. And this one is, I mean, Islanders hockey. They're one up to this point, they're 1-for-19 in the series on the power play. Our penalty kill has been great, but 19th, 20th power play already, and we're in kind of the start of game five still, and it's like, it's got to crack at some point. And it's just, I felt like we got a little bit, I've loved this power play camera they've done throughout these playoffs. And then we just start getting chasing, and we get lost, and we get twist turned around, and it's a wide open net, and he tucks it home.
Yeah, you got Brendan Dillon up on the top left, and Carl Hagman behind him. It's just, yeah, people just losing their spots.
Yeah.
That's all it really is right there. I mean, you get chasing the puck right there. Look at that. Look, all four guys were kind of chasing the puck there. And
yeah, and it squeaks out like everybody's twisting and turning. Once you lose sight of that puck and once you start going back to front on a PK, that's when it really starts to fall apart for you. And I feel like right here, maybe we got a little too aggressive right here. Eller has to stretch out, leaves Nelson right there in the middle alone, and then it's able to make him allow him to make that puck pop out, and Pavilier cleans up, feeds the chickens.
Dylan, that's Haglund's guy, 100%.
But Dylan gets caught up there and kind of gets caught chasing a little bit. See how far back he has to come back?
Yeah.
So rewind that all the way back to the front.
Right here. It's right here when he does too much.
Dylan, right
and
there.
And then he starts to turn. You got to know, dude, back attack. That guy's back's to you. You got to attack. You're not turn around and settle yourself.
No, but keep watching. Keep watching. Now
he gets caught
all the way up here. Why is he poke checking there?
Just poke right here. So he gets extended. You got Hags up there extended. You got Eller in the middle. And look how wide open it leaves that left side. And you can't even see their fifth guy. They don't need one because they're
right.
Beating up 4-on-4 right now. I mean, he's up here at the bottom of your screen. But it's an easy stretch pass. We freak out. Dylan has to get back. Haglund has to rush back. Like I said, leaves Nelson in the middle because Eller has to overcommit now to make up for that long stretch pass. You should if you're penalty killing, you should not allow board-to-board passes.
Both watching the puck right here. Both are watching the puck. They're not watching a guy behind them. They're not picking up a loose guy. Look at the guy right in front of Holpe.
Yeah, it's been the same story all series. Just not taking the body in front of the net until it's too late. And he's able to get that clean in there. And then
slow guy out front. He was by himself for a split second there. He gets the puck over to Bevilier. I mean, that's just people following the puck the entire way. Man.
We all four eyes are on the puck right here for the Caps.
Yep.
And it's just once you're watching the puck, you don't know where anybody is, and it's in the back of your net before you can fucking blink. And,
let me ask you guys this. When are we taught to pick up the loose man?
All day, every day.
I was gonna say we're 12. I think we're taught to pick up the loose man.
Bevilia was fucking due though on the power play.
Keith Jones on NBC saying Reardon should be fired.
Oh yeah, dude, Milbury was ripping it.
Motherfucker Milbury. The whole disinterested thing grinds my gears, but I'm like, I think I hate it because I agree.
No, I typically hate Mike Milbury, but he was just laying into like. He wasn't saying Ty Reardon's name, but he was saying this seems like a coaching issue like the entire game. And I was like, this is the Mike Milbury that I can get with. Like when me and Mike Milbury agree with something, that's a good thing. Because I usually disagree with him on a lot of different things.
Yeah, I mean it's such a fucking tough situation, man. But yeah, like it's like I hate Milbury and I'm tweeting about him like disinterested count. Ovi's disinterested. Like, dude, Ovi, he said Ovi didn't show up till last game. It's like, buddy, did you watch the game before when he had two fucking goals? Like What are we talking about here? But I mean, yeah, that's the first one. So the second one, and Bobby just texted me actually. I don't know if he saw the video or what, but he said Carlson's about to be on a lot of people's highlight reels, and this is one of them. And let me say, boy, I love Carlson to death, man. But as hard as we stand him as a Norris Trophy winner, and to see him get completely dummied,
dude.
What did he finish? -10.
He's looked really bad defensively.
It happened the last half of the season. I mean, he just lost his game. He had an incredible start to the season, but yeah, this was bad.
And it's just sloppy.
Yeah.
It's sloppy, man.
Fishing for the puck. All right, rewind that and slow it down a little bit. I mean, well, one, you got two forwards. You don't have a single guy in the high slot you don't have a single forward being responsible there.
Right.
Is this a 4-on-4 goal or is this 5-on-5?
This is 5-on-5.
That's what I thought. And yeah, there's not a single.
It's a simple chip over. Like, what? You see that play start to develop right here. You know this play's developing. It's an easy in.
Well, you isn't this kind of what we talked about, the overtime goal between Carlson and Dylan? No communication. Both guys go to the puck carrier here.
Boom. He's
fishing for the puck and thinks he can still get over to Beauvillier.
Carlson's looking the opposite way at the moment.
Dude, I got to be honest. They're lucky it wasn't Barzal, because Barzal could just
split the D and take it in himself.
Yes, exactly.
Whoop, and it's just a clean one. And goddamn, we are so sorry, Holpe. Tom Wilson gives him a nice shot. This series isn't. I think it was going to be in series until we had a question.
Go back like 2 seconds. It looked like Holpe just started screaming at Carlson right there. Right there. I don't know if it might just be me, but it looks like he makes like a little head move right here at Carlson, and he's like, "What the
dude, fuck you do?" Yeah, I see that. Yeah, it's just like, come on, man! Like, you're leaving me out the fucking dry all series.
Thanks. I mean, they absolutely were too. I mean, Carlson was. It's funny. Our two best defensemen were probably our worst defensemen. Carlson and Orlov did not play well at all.
I mean, Christ! At one point, Milbury said that Gudas and Dylan were the two best players on the Caps tonight.
I know, and I would have disagreed with Dylan, but I maybe would have agreed with Gudas, honestly. I didn't
step the game up.
Yeah, I was going to say, I didn't notice him do anything terrible, which usually means he's pretty good.
He played solid tonight.
Yeah, so. And
it's pretty frustrating.
Oh, it's extremely frustrating. You kidding me? So that's the only two goals we're going to show. Obviously, it's a 4-0 loss, guys. The Caps out in game 5. I'm glad it's over. Get us home. Let's figure some shit out. Take whatever time we're getting off, because there obviously hasn't been a decision on next season. We're obviously not starting right in October per usual, because the Stanley Cup final that we're not going to be in is going to be all the way up until like October 2nd or 4th, I think they said, is like the latest Game 7 would be. But there's obviously a lot to talk about this offseason, so I mean, let's kind of start to get into it. All right, Blake, a couple players that you would like to see on the move this offseason.
This is probably not going to be popular, although I have seen other people on Twitter suggest that. I think we need to at least shop Orlov.
Okay.
I don't hate it.
It's quasi-popular. It's been mentioned. It's not like a random, tweet.
It's a polarizing thing. Like, I think there's people who would be like, yeah, let's get rid of Orlov. And there's people who would be like, nah, keep him forever. And I think I don't know if we necessarily need to trade him, but I think we need to at least see what the market is for him. Because you
could get a good return for him.
He's rebranded himself as this defensive defenseman, and I think that's what he can be, except for amongst Capitals defensemen, he allowed the second most expected goals per hour of ice time this season, except for John Carlson, who we all know doesn't play any actual defense, and we're never going to trade him. So I think the next guy that needs to be at least on the block is Orlov. See what you can get for him. See if you can get somebody who can cover for Carlson's mistakes and turnovers and inability to cover guys on the rush. So he's the first guy I'd shop. The second guy, again, I hate to say, like, I want this guy gone, because I don't want this guy gone, but we've got, a year or two of Ovi and Backstrom left? Like, that's our window, is however long Ovi and Backstrom are still dominant. I'd say we got to shop Travis Boyd. We got to see what we can get from him.
I mean, that's all right. I'd like to see him in the lineup. I would like to see him in the lineup this series.
I would love to see him, but they're clearly unsure about him. And
my thing is, I don't think they would get anyone worthwhile to even shop him at that point. You know what I mean? I mean, unless you're going for the future and getting a prospect out of it, I would agree. But if we're trying to win in the next 1 or 2 years, like, who would you get out?
Well, we're also going to have to see what forward we lose in the expansion draft,
which is let's just say it, TJ Oshie.
Good possibility.
It's been talked about by everybody.
This year, right?
The summer's the expansion draft? Not the summer, but
it was supposed to be, but I don't know if it's going to change.
Summer 2021.
Oh, so it's not till next season.
Okay.
So we still got another year of Oshie.
That's fine then. I'm fine then. Kovalchuk, get the fuck out. Over that. We tried it. It didn't work.
Montreal. We're not getting anything for him.
Yeah.
He's
walking. Yeah.
I feel like obviously now you kind of wish you got something for Holtby, but at the trade deadline, it was like, there's this is close to the end of our window. We might as well keep our
work. You're not going to do your guy like that for one.
Right.
Season. Yeah. I was never a fan of the trade Holtby bandwagon at the trade. No,
not a chance. We were living and dying by Holtby this year.
Yeah. Right. It was worth the risk of what ended up happening to keep him, especially because he turned his crap around. Like Holtby, I have a lot of very mixed feelings about Braden Holtby, but whatever you feel about
absolute
him,
legend.
He turned it around in the playoffs.
Yeah. I mean, he did well.
I would say I would agree with that because I'm not going to lie. I was also one of those people that as well as Holtby did throughout his entire career and how consistent he was, I was just always so hard on him. I mean, I'm the most negative Caps fan of all time, I think.
Yeah.
I'm always hard on everyone.
The opposite.
Huh?
You and KP are like opposite ends of the
spectrum. Oh, yeah. Yeah,
it's funny because literally in the group text tonight, verbatim, this is what said. AB out of nowhere. Kyle, I'm sick and tired of your "we're going to win every game" attitude. I hate you and your positivity. And Kyle just goes, "Yeah, man, I'm different from your negative attitude."
Yeah. So I'm
verbatim.
I'm the negative Caps fan of all time. I'm always looking on the downside. And Holtby, but at the end of the road, like I appreciate the
credit.
Like it was the same way with Mike Green. I always used to shit on Mike Green. And at the end
Burakovsky?
Of the road, Burakovsky same way. At the end of the road, like when they finally left, I was like, "Damn, it's gonna suck to not have him." Like Mike Green was the one. I didn't really Burakovsky. I was like, "Yeah, go on. He's a peacock. You gotta let him
fly. Let him fucking fly, baby. Let him fly."
Mike Green, I was pretty sad when I saw him leave. I was like, "Damn, that sucks."
Yeah, that's one guy that I kind of like. This is a topic or discussion for today. I'm gonna be like, win the cup.
I'm gonna be the same way with Holtby because. He did play so well. I mean, I was as a fan, I was super hard on him. Like when he didn't play a perfect game, I was like, "What the fuck? Like, what are you doing?"
Right.
But he was one of the most consistent goalies in the NHL. He gave us the ride of our lives, basically. I mean, he was the second best, third best player in that 2018 Stanley Cup, and he also made the most important play in that 2018 Stanley Cup. I would say.
Yeah.
Besides, the Lars Eller overtime goal against Columbus is probably number one.
Mm-hmm.
And Braden Holtby saves number two. The Kuzi goal against Pittsburgh is number three, is what I have in order for that Stanley Cup.
Yeah, I agree.
Do you feel like, would you be happy if we made a move to keep Holtby and we freed up some cap space?
I got you, Johnny.
Made it happen? Or do you think it's time to move on?
Blake's got me going here with an Orlov trade. Now I'm like, oh, shoot. Do we keep him?
Yeah, I didn't know that until it came out of my face. Like, if we trade Orlov, we might have space for Holtby.
We might have some space.
I know, but or is it time?
Orlov's at 5-1. Orlov's at 5-1.
Especially because not only did Holtby's kind of market value drop with kind of a weak year this year, especially pre kind of March.
Bobrovsky did not help.
Bobrovsky was going to be the next word out of my mouth. Bobrovsky tanked the goalie market by just absolutely blowing chunks this year. That drop.
That's expected, though. Like, fuck, man.
I mean, you can't pay a goalie $10 million a year, but like that absolutely dropped a bunch of value off of Holtby's potential value. Just right there, like even if Holtby had stood on his head and stole the entire playoffs this year, that still would have dropped. Bobrovsky would have dropped Holtby's value. So there might be some room there, especially if we make a move with Orlov and another guy. So my next guy that I was going to say is we got to shop is Kempney. I don't know.
He was a one hit wonder. I'm starting to realize.
Yeah. Yep.
I don't know what we'll get for him, but
Gudas is walking. He's done.
Yeah.
Re-signed the fuck out of Brendan Dillon.
Absolutely. They're, we cannot let Brendan Dillon go. We can't. I mean, that would be a mistake.
I agree. He's got to fix the penalties, though.
He does.
Which I think we can with the right coach. Someone that disciplines these guys.
Like Gerard Gallant?
Maybe. Maybe you.
I wouldn't hate it.
I kind of want to read off some fucking free agent defensemen and Alex Petrangelo, Barry, Justin Schultz, well, we're not gonna get Andy Green. I know, I just like to read them though.
We're not going to get any of those guys, but
you might get Andy Green because he's 75 years old.
Well, he retired, quasi-retired, something like that. Let's get to this part of the show. Let's read some tweets from Samantha Pell from some of the players here. Braden Holtby, when asked if this could have been his last game at the Capitol, certainly a chance it is, but who knows? You live one day at a time and go from there. Braden Holtby again on the season coming to an end, just disappointed. It's never a fun thing to go through. It's more frustrating for us that we had more to give and we didn't find a way to do it. Alex Ovechkin simply says they scored, we didn't. Nick Backstrom says, I think it's over five games. They wanted it more than us. That's all it is. That's all we've got. So, yeah, don't disagree with any of it.
I mean, they're younger. They're hungrier at this point. I mean, you got to think, like, in the back of their minds a little bit, like, they finally got Ovi's cup. It's like, so are they like, all right, we got it once. Like, not the whole, like, we're good, but, like, if you don't have the cup, you are more desperate for it than when you did, than when you do have it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and before the first time you win it.
That's like, there's no way that people are telling, like, those players are telling me that, like, Crosby's going to tell me that the third time he won the cup was better than the first time. No fucking shot, dude.
No.
That third period was, to me, kind of just exemplified, you know, not the they're sort of packing it in, giving it up, but, like, for lack of a better term, they were like,
yeah.
There's
no hope there.
To put it into numbers, normally this season, teams that are losing put up like 2.5 expected goals per hour. In that third period, we only put up one. That's less than half of what you'd expect. And that was in an elimination game down two. And we're a very offensive minded team. We should be putting up more expected goals than you'd expect, so to speak. And we,
hate to chime in, but my God, Mike Milbury's just acting a fool. Did you see what he just said now? It was quote, like right there at the end of the Cavs game. If you think about it, it's a terrific environment. If you enjoy playing and enjoy being with your teammates for long periods of time, it's a perfect place, is what the first commentator says. And Mike Milbury responds, but there's not even any women here to disrupt their concentration. Oh, can't say that, man. You're going to get canceled. And I kind of hope he does because he's a fucking loser. But
he should have been canceled after insinuating that Maple Leafs player faked an injury when he got.
Oh, that was terrible.
Muzzin. Well, right. Carlson, I got another quote for you here. Carlson asked if he was playing hurt. He quote on said, I was playing at this time of the year. No one feels great. He had 4 months of rest. Unless you got COVID,
he had that injury pre.
Yeah, but no one feels great. It seems like the entire fucking Islanders team feels great to me.
They seem very fantastic.
Colorado, Colorado's winning 6-0 and 7-1 back to back.
That's a weak comment, man. Like, what do you mean? If this was like, it'd be different if this was actually April and like the entire regular season played out. Then I'd be like, yeah, no one's feeling good.
We got a Todd Reardon quote. It says, "This is not acceptable for organization." Add on to that. It's not acceptable. Your former organization, you bitch. KP, I want to talk to you about something. I want to talk to you about Hagelin. I want to talk to you about the bottom six. Obviously, no production anywhere outside of Ovechkin, Kuznetsov, and Oshie on the power play, but bottom six is where you live and die in the playoffs, and we just weren't really seeing it at all. And then even today, we see Hagelin, your guy, down on the fourth line. Did you like that switch with Hagelin and Panic, or should have stayed the same? Fourth line grind got disrupted.
I mean, at this point, I like the switch because you needed to create something. They weren't generating any offense at all. You weren't getting that secondary scoring. Right. So it was a little bit of a spark. I thought Hagelin was out there flying today. I thought he had a little more speed. And I liked it with the veterans on that third line, Kovalchuk, Panic, and Backstrom. But obviously it didn't work out. So,
yeah,
I mean,
I
just don't think they had the scoring ability.
I mean, I think the Kovalchuk experiment is obviously a huge failure, which,
yeah, but I mean, hey, I'm glad you took the risk. I'm glad we took that risk.
What pisses me off about it, we didn't really experiment with it enough. Like, we didn't even give it like a full two games or like anything with the top line. Yeah, we just wasted his minutes on the third line. But
that's
it's
what
over.
I was going to get into is that the Kovalchuk experiment, it was fun, right? Like, everyone was like, holy shit, we got him. He's with the Russians. Let's fucking do this. And what do? We put him with, in the regular season, Lars Eller, Carl Hagelin, and Ilya Kovalchuk. Two pretty defensive forwards, I would say. Am I wrong there?
No.
I was going to say, two pretty defensive forwards with a guy who only wants to score goals. And that's not going to get him going. He really didn't get going. I think he only had one goal with us, right, in that Ranger game?
Yeah.
So he doesn't get going. COVID happens, whatever. Playoffs takes us like 5 months later.
We'll get the full training camp to learn our systems.
Right.
Find a line.
Exactly. Lines don't change at all. And in the round robin, nothing is getting generated, really, to be quite honest. And it's just like, all right, so what? Like, you either – you're at the point where, like, I mean, Kovalchuk, I mean, at this point, it's just like you either scratch him or you play him on the top two lines. Like, Montreal, like, everyone was like, oh, shit, Kovalchuk may have gotten a spark in Montreal. Like, he looks good. Montreal was winning games. He scored – like, he was scoring some, like, pretty huge goals. But if you go back and look at his stats, he only had 10 goals the entire season in 48 games. That's mm-hmm. not very good. I mean, it's not the worst, but it's not great. I mean
– below average.
Yeah, and I think he probably would have been on pace for, what, like 17, 18 goals? I don't know off the top of my head, but if he played 82 games. But, again, it's just like he was playing top two – he's playing top 6 minutes in Montreal, so that's why he was scoring. We get him. He's very excited to be here, and then you play him with – nobody that like he only
you
wants
see a
to,
picture of Ovechkin totally on Instagram, role. Him and Ovechkin on Instagram in like December, and everybody's like, oh my god, is he coming to DC? It's like, hey, he came here because Ovi.
You're
he
playing
came here because of the Russians, and you're not gonna put him with any of them.
Yeah, he's only having fun with those guys for some reason. I mean, it's Russian blood, whatever, blah, motherland. You don't play him with them. Like, I wouldn't even want him. I honestly don't want Ovechkin and Kovalchuk on the same line. I think that's a recipe for disaster. But maybe Kuzi and Kovalchuk on the same line with like Vrana. I know that's a very bad defensive line, but it could also be a lot of speed through the neutral zone that just breaks through. I don't know. Like, it's just experimenting. And Todd Reirden
they didn't play around with him enough. They didn't ever try the let's pull the goalie without pulling the goalie by putting Kovalchuk with two other offensive guys. They never tried him with Vrana.
Yep.
Like, they absolutely did not try
Vrana. Stuff him with Russians.
They didn't put him with Ovi enough. They didn't do anything to try
Ovi,
to get
Kuzi, kind of Kovi.
A pure offensive guy. Like, picking him up. If you're not gonna get the offense out of him.
Yeah, I mean, the way I see it, it's kind of like bringing Kovalchuk in and putting him on the third line and not like – if you're going to smoke meth or do crack or trip on shrooms for the first time, get high as fuck. You know what I'm saying? Don't just like – don't be like, I'm going to get so high and then like just puff the joint once and pass it, dude. Like, if you're going to do it, fucking do it. If you're going to bring a guy like Kovalchuk in, a premier elite sniper from way the fuck back in Atlanta days, and – put him with Ovi and Kuznetsov the entire time. Get high as shit, man. Don't just sit there and be like, well, stick him on the third line. That's why I brought Kovalchuk in. No, man. Let him. If you're going to try that experiment, fucking balls to the walls with it.
It's like getting Antonio Brown and just having him as your third receiver. Honestly.
Having giving him a couple looks a game. That's it.
What do you do?
Yeah.
I mean, so that's another thing. Like, Kovalchuk is low key probably at this point in his career, he can't really do much. He's pretty fucking old. He's probably a power play specialist though.
Yeah.
He just didn't get any power play time either. Like, you have to – I think that's a huge thing. I mean, I know we have a lot of big-ass names on our team that, like, you can put on a power play, so there's not room for Kovalchuk. But I think you just have to test the waters out at some point. Like, he's –
especially when the power play is not doing a damn thing.
The 17th-ranked power play.
Well, you can go back to win the
playoffs. It was so bad. He didn't do any experimental things with the fucking power play. I mean, if you watch today, Ovechkin is just he's going from the office to the back post, and it's just like, dude, OV, you're kind of a like not a nuisance, but you're irrelevant when you do that. Like we need to move OV around.
Yeah.
I mean, now we're getting into like different than Kobe. It's just like do something different.
Yeah, Ovi's got to be gone from the office.
Huh?
I think Ovi's got to be gone from the office. It just kills so much momentum.
No,
Kuzi was doing a lot of jamming tonight. He does need to rotate.
They need to put him in like the TJ Oshie spot, and then he can pop out to the office every once in a while instead of just sitting in the office, stagnant.
Like slowly stagnant fucking
battle. It sucks.
Slip back. I mean, so I read you guys that quote from Reardon. This is not acceptable for our organization already. Another quote from Reardon. Our team wasn't able to mentally and physically get to our game for long enough. Our team. So I texted you guys this a couple of days ago. I don't know if I mentioned it last show, but I don't think I did. So I'll compare two quotes from Rod Brendamore. After I think it was game three or game four, they had the 2-0 lead in the third period. Boston comes back and wins it, 4-3 in the third? Rod Brendamore quote, "That's not something I've seen out of us ever. I'll take the heat for that. I needed to have my guys better for that third period, and I'll learn. And then Rob Brendamore again goes, "I love this team. I love my guys, but we learned a tough lesson today, though, and we'll bounce back from it." And you got Reardon saying, "You know, our team wasn't able to mentally and physically get to our game for long enough. So, you know, it is what it is. Take a little responsibility. Maybe an ounce of it. You're the fucking head coach of the Washington Capitals, dude. You're the head coach of any team in the NHL. You take responsibility. It's on you. It's always on you. Penalties are on you. And I'm tired of Cap's Twitter. Quit whining about the refs, man. We take a lot of penalties, but quit whining. The Islanders got a too many men for having four guys on the ice tonight.
Yeah.
Literally.
It's not the refs. We just take
quit fucking whining. It's a bad look.
Our penalties are stupid.
Like, if you watch them on the replay every single time, they are definitely penalties. The only one that I had a problem with was, I think, Lars Eller hook. I was just like, that was kind of weak, but
it looked like a hook at least. I mean, it obviously wasn't, but I can see how somebody just looking at that in real time would go, "Oh yeah, that's a hook."
Well, after game one, we knew they were going to call it tight. You weren't going to get away with the little shit, and we never corrected it.
All right, time out. I need to go get more beer. Actually, time in. You guys can continue, but I'm getting more beer.
All right.
Reardon apparently got questioned about if he's confident he'll be the coach next year. So,
well, yeah,
fired up media. We
should talk about that. Is I hate saying give a coach just 2 years and gone, but Todd's really shown nothing. Like, he's not made any changes. It's been the same thing 2 years in a row. He hasn't got this team motivated at all. I mean, I don't think he can get anything out of this team.
That was the same top six we saw get killed by Carolina.
Robin. Yeah,
right. It wasn't even forget different from this season. It wasn't lots different.
Lazy stick penalty.
Yeah,
laziness.
It's laziness. It's stupidity. I mean,
they don't buy into like a team. I guess with him, they just don't buy into a team aspect.
I'll start this question with you two, and then I'll get to AB because I know he'll want to jump in on this one. But ever since we won the cup, do you find us being last season and this season, like, I think we're less of a threat post-cup championship than we ever have been since. When was the last time we missed the playoffs? Was that 2013 or 14 or something? I don't think we've been this less of a threat than since then.
Well, we don't have the desperation. I mean, that's what we talked about all series, and that's maybe what it's from. We got the one cup, so we're kind of we lost it, lost that extra desperation that they had before.
Yeah.
But which I hope it's not, but I mean, what else are you going to blame it on?
I don't.
We're back.
I don't know what it is, man. I think to be perfectly honest with you, I think we've lost like a smidge of talent from the 2018 team. But other than that, I think we're seeing a lot of similar drive to what we were seeing prior to the cup. Like, I think a lot of the stuff that we've been talking about this, I was watching the back-to-back years against the Penguins and going, this can't keep happening. Stuff like not keeping the puck in the zone, simple shit like that that we just weren't doing. And then all of a sudden, we managed to put it together for 16 games in 2018. I say this a lot about Holtby, and I think it's true of a lot of the team, is that they all put it together for 16 games in 2018. And that was kind of it. Before that and after that, it hasn't been
that at all. We're talking about how we don't think this team is a Stanley Cup threat. They're like, we're less of a Stanley Cup threat now than we were since 2014 when we didn't make the playoffs.
1,000% because of our defense. I mean, I'm not saying it's because of our defensive players individually. I just think when you look at the names that we had on defense, that should tell you the issue, right? Or not the issue, but like that should just tell you it right there. Like, so we had John Carlson, up and coming John Carlson, right? Who we've always thought he is a top 10 defender in this league. Honestly, until this year, even though he might win the Norris, the last half of that year, he played awful. But we had Brooks Orpik.
In terms of actual defense the whole year.
We had Brooks Orpik, who, again, another player that I used to always shit on because he was terrible with the puck, but he was so good in front of our own net, and he kept everyone accountable. Like, that, he was just a leader in the goddamn locker room. Yeah, we had Matt Niskanen, right, who I thought is – the most consistent defender in the entire NHL. I mean, that's obviously biased a little bit, but even with the Flyers, like, Flyers fans love him. And I'm like, yeah, that's what he – you know what you're getting from Matt Niskanen every single night. And I thought he was one of the best – I think he's one of the best defensemen in the league, low-key, to have on your roster. Because he just
– I just retweeted it, the Caps, and saw they changed everything like ASAP. Well, Matt Niskanen, let's talk about him real quick. Should at least have 3-game suspension, not one.
I disagree.
Just a straight cross-check to the jaw and shattering it. If Wilson does that same exact play, it's probably 5 games in the playoffs.
I mean, yeah, but
I just don't think Niskanen's a guy that has a reputation for that. I don't think
one's a little weak.
I didn't think he should have gotten suspended, to be quite honest. I mean, I haven't seen it all the way through. I didn't think he should have got I don't think he should have got suspended. I think Flyers fans are obviously livid right now about it. I thought the Koskinen hit was worse than the Niskanen hit. That's my personal opinion.
Watching a couple of the Department of Player Safety stuff today, I was kind of like, that's not
good. Koskinen leaves his feet to make that hit. That's why when everyone like lost their minds that should only be 2 minutes, I was just like, nah, he jumped at that guy to hit him because he's shorter and the other guy's taller. Right. But anyway, we're getting off track here. Our top four D when we won the cup was amazing. And then who was our fifth and sixth? We had John Carlson Kempe. We had Orlov Niskanen. And then we had Brooks Orpik as our fifth and Christian Jews at the time. Like, that decor is just so much better than what we have now. And you can't even question it.
It's a lot stronger, tougher, and they play well positioned in front of the net. They clear guys out, which we had a problem with all series.
And they're smarter with the puck.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they make the easy pass. They make the correct pass. None of that stupid backhand shit out the zone.
And they have way more confidence.
They lack confidence.
Niskanen's not necessarily a great stick handler, but like he knows when to make the right decisions. Brooks Orpik, he's terrible with the puck, but he knows how to make the right decisions.
Tape passes.
It's just decision making, and our defense right now just doesn't know how to do that.
It doesn't help that one of our better defensive defensemen has been Siegenthaler, and this is his first real year as a real player.
Right. And
he's still learning the ropes. I mean, you guys know Siegenthaler's my boy. I have high hopes for him. I think he's going to be, you know, what Brooks Orpik was at his peak. I think that's that's.
I'm with you on that. I'm with you on that.
I'm very high on Caller, but for right now, we can't depend on him the way we depended on Orpik, because Siegenthaler is what, 15 years younger than Brooks Orpik?
Yep.
Like, he's young, he's going to make dumb mistakes, and you really need to be able to pair him with a guy. Like, this is one of those, this is a season where you would have wanted Orpik Siegenthaler as a pairing, so that Siegenthaler would get the kind of mentorship from Orpik that he's not going to get from Gudas, because all Gudas does is turn the puck over and take suspensions.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, I agree with that. A guy like Orpik would definitely be a good guy to mentor him.
Which, I mean, he is there for that, right? He's player development,
right?
You know?
Yeah. But he's not on the ice and in the locker. Like, is Orpik even in the
bubble? No, that's definitely a different aspect when somebody takes you under your wing like that, playing side by side a full season.
Right. Yeah, I would shop Kempney and I'd shop Orlov and see if I can get somebody who can mentor Siegenthaler into being that Orpik kind of guy.
So if you successfully shop Orlov, would you re-sign Holpe?
I mean, it depends what kind of hometown discount Holpe's willing to take. Because, I mean, it's going to have to be a hometown discount, no matter what kind of salary cap and finagling and trading we do. He's ultimately, regardless of how bad Bobrovsky did this year, there's going to have to be a hometown discount, especially with the salary cap not going up because of COVID. Well, like,
would you want him long term?
No.
No, like,
I mean, you'd have to sign like a 2 or 3 year deal max, because, I mean, Samsonov is got to start to be the guy. I mean,
and
if he got more playoff experience this year, I would have been happy with just going with him.
And that's the other thing, too, is I would back up. I would go Sammy Holpe, not Holpe Sammy. And that's another thing that you'd have to, like is Holpe going to be willing to take that when he can go to, you know, somewhere else, make more money, play more, you know, maybe get a second cup that he's not going to get more money, more time, or more cups here. I don't see him taking it.
It's kind of like Severin says here, like it, like Hope, does Hope even want to stay? Like, it's kind of like Carl Alsner. Like, Carl Alsner obviously didn't want to stay. I mean, sucks for him. Like, as soon as he left, he's now out of the fucking NHL, which kind of is terrible. But that's not going to happen to Holpe, obviously. But
yeah. Hopefully not.
He's not going to want to stay for 2 or 3 years. I think Holpe's at the time in his life
where he wants term
for 8 years and at $8.5 million or something. I don't know. How much would you pay for Holpe for 2 or 3 years?
How much would
if we can get him around 8, 9?
I wouldn't pay a penny over 8. And
yeah, 8.
If he says $8 million and a penny, I say have fun in Montreal.
I wouldn't pay him anything over $7 million. Are you kidding me?
What?
You ain't getting him for 7.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Holpe,
you gotta at least make
him that good in the regular. Is he that good in the regular season to pay that much money to and keep
him
around?
No, keep him as a backup. Keep him for the playoff experience.
You want to pay a backup goalie $8 million
for 2 years?
Yeah. While we still have Ovechkin, we're trying to win a cup
for the goalie of our next decade. I might be willing to overpay by $1 million for an extra year or two.
Exactly.
But he's not going to take that.
No, he's not going to take it. He's not going to take it.
Depends on what the market's going to be. You never know. If it's not there, he might want to take it and bet on himself.
He's not going to take it, but I would sign him for 8.5 for 2 years. That would be my contract to offer him. He's not going to take that, but that's what I would do.
The market is going to be, because there's no way he's getting 10 mil because of the way Bobrovsky played and because of the way he played. So the market's coming down at least to not at most 9 mil, I think.
I think we'll get above 9.
You think who do you think is gonna pay him $9.5 million?
I think, well, actually I was gonna say Vancouver, but I think Markstrom has solidified his spot there.
Maybe Arizona, maybe Chicago.
Arizona's cool with Darcy Kemper. They're super cool with him right now. Low key Toronto. Like, if they trade, if Toronto trades Freddie Anderson, which they very well could, I could see Toronto signing Holtby for like 2 or 3 years, or signing to a long contract for a very big, expensive.
What's their cap?
They've been trying to trade.
They're going to be up against it, or at least they're going to be up against it soon, especially with Matthews, Marner, whoever else. Like, they have some star power there that is going to be commanding cap space pretty soon, especially with the cap not going up because of COVID.
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, they already got through their superstardom. They don't – like, because, I mean, Marner's already signed, right? Matthews is already signed. Tavares is already signed. Nylander's already signed. Yep. They have their four guys signed. It's their defense that they have an issue with, right? And, like, I think this year they learned that – I think they learned that Freddie Anderson is not really the answer. I mean, Freddie Anderson is good, but he has a couple goals, and they're not in the playoffs, obviously, or they lost in the qualifiers or whatever. And I think they realize that they need a guy
who can still
buy a top 10 goalie. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't think Freddie Anderson is that guy.
Oh yeah, definitely.
No.
So I don't know. I mean, Kyle, where do you see him going? Holtby?
I mean, I don't know. I kind of would be fine with Holtby going at this point. I think it's Samsonov's time. I think he can take the reins, and I'd like them to make a move with coaching and making a move defensively.
Yeah. I want to see a bunch of changes on the defensive. I want to see them get more pure defensemen. Especially with somebody to go with Carlson's just complete inability to defend pretty much anything, but especially the rush. I mean, like that Malkin dangle from earlier in the year is just
it's
for a Norris Trophy candidate.
It's
and
so miserable, dude.
Yeah.
Yeah. You got to have somebody who can take care of the fact, because you're not getting rid of Carlson for like 17,000 reasons you're not getting rid of Carlson, and you shouldn't do it, but you got to have somebody who can bail him out of the situations he gets himself into. Because Carlson signed for what, 7 more years after this? In 2 or 3 years, that guy is going to be Siegenthaler, but that guy right now is not Siegenthaler yet. And no. You got to have somebody in the meantime, especially with your window of Ovechkin Backstrom closing as rapidly as it is.
Yeah, that brings into a lot. I mean, even brings it back to the Holtby thing. If you can get Holtby for 2 more years, Ovechkin 2 more years. I mean, we know, AB, we've talked about the goalie that teams nowadays have to have these two goalie tandems. I mean, that does bring it into a whole nother equation.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's kind of why I want Holtby for like at least 1 more year, 2 more years. But I mean, I know that's not going to happen. But at this point, it kind of is what it is. I mean, he's gone. We have to, like,
yeah,
the thing that I liked about Holtby is he's probably the most consistent goalie in the league, or one of the most consistent goalies in the league, I would say. I mean,
you knew what you were getting out of him. I always felt like he was never the number one goalie in the league, except for maybe his Vezina year. You know, I would almost always put Carey Price or Henrik Lundqvist or one of those guys ahead of him in terms of like pure ability. But in terms of, you knew exactly what the hell you were going to get out of him day in and day out. You knew exactly what you're getting from Holtby.
Yeah, because he's probably, I would say he's probably the number one competitor out of goalies. The only other competitor out of goalies that I would put over him is probably Jonathan Quick. And and he dropped off like a bad habit very quickly. But like
Quick.
Yeah, there you go. And like, it's just, I mean, Lundqvist, he had a long ass career, but he dropped off. I mean, he's not even, who knows.
I want to see him go back up Grubauer in Colorado or somebody and go get him a cup, because Henrik Lundqvist deserves a cup, kind of the way that like Ovi deserved a cup. Like, he's one of the greats, and the fact that he hasn't gotten one sucks. And I would love to go see him win one on somebody else's back. You know, like,
you know what's funny about him is that, like, he's living and dying by the Rangers. Like, he told the Rangers, "I don't want to be moved." And it's just like, bro, they're rebuilding, and like, you almost have to let them rebuild. One, two, like, go get yourself a cup, because at the time when they were trying to like make this decision, they were like, they weren't even close to a cup. But now they've won two fucking lotteries in a row. It's like, what the fuck? Now they might actually win a cup in the next 2 years. But that's neither near here nor there. But I don't know. It's just it's a difficult situation with Holtby. Like we said, like, trading Orlov would be awesome, but like, you're only keeping Holtby for 1 or 2 years, and after that you got to get rid of him, obviously.
If the Caps re-sign him, like let's say we trade Orlov, we make all the cap space, we make this happen, Holtby takes a massive hometown discount, I'm still trading him the trade deadline of the last year of that contract, whether it be this year or next year. Like, yeah, he's not sticking around for the full contract, and I don't think he should.
I would agree. I'm almost talking myself into Kyle's perspective, where you need to let Samsonov take over at some point.
Well, what Blake just said, I mean, if you're gonna trade him at the if that's the plan, you want to trade him at a trade deadline to get something for him, I wouldn't even do it, because the only reason I'd keep him is for the playoff experience, the ability to jump in the playoffs if Samsonov was our guy and something was to happen.
Yeah, that's true.
If you can get him for 2 years and get another playoffs out of him, then go for it. But if you can't get a full 2 years, then maybe it's time to just move on. Even if you trade, even if you make all the cap space that you need.
Yeah, 100%. I mean, that's all I got, boys.
Yeah, me too.
It's pretty fucking disappointing ending. I kind of think that we all saw it coming, to be quite honest.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just pissed that they fucking could have flipped the switch. They could have done it, but
yeah, I mean, they played pretty bad during the last half of the regular season. They played the same way in the round robin, and they played the same way for pretty much every single period of hockey in this series except for two of them.
Well, you've been saying it. I mean, we just got to realize this is the team. This is it. They proved it, that this is who they are.
Yeah.
Accept it and move on. So, is what it is. Game 5, first round, and we're out of here. Back-to-back, early exits, 2 years in a row. Hopefully it's 2 years for a massive offseason shakeup, I think.
Peace out, Tiger. Hey, I will say this. This is what last thing. Billman, I wanted you in here for this. When we had our interview with Tarek,
uh-huh,
he's like, "All right, relax. Let's relax. Like, they'll find their way. They'll find their way through. And come March, we'll start to worry." March happened. We started worrying, and we did. Me and you told him, we were like, "Dude, I think it's a Todd Rittman problem."
Yeah, we did. We did say it off air.
Off air.
Beforehand. Yeah, off air.
We think it's a Todd Rittman problem. He's like, "No. He's like, the players really believe in him." Yeah, I'm sure they do. But
let's see. We'll see. But yeah, it is what it is. I mean, thanks guys for tuning in all post game, even though it was only five games in the first round and the 4-round robins in that Carolina game. But hey, it was a fucking good time. We tried it out. So thanks for tuning in all playoffs. And guys, anything else to say?
That's it.
If you want us to follow another team, let's do it.
Canucks, let's go.
Put it up. Tweet at us. And if we get enough responses and people want us to cover another team,
Canucks, Colorado, do love Colorado.
Here's the only stipulation: it has to have a former Cap on the team, and it's not going to be. It can't be Philly.
Yeah, screw Philly.
Has to have a former Cap. Can't be Philly.
Does Barry Trotz count as a former Cap?
100%.
No.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Oh, he does.
He does.
All right, guys.
That guy Blake said absolutely not.
Do the finals. Maybe we just fuck around away from the finals.
Well, the votes, me and Vilma voted yes, so you're the final vote, AB.
What about Barry Trotz?
Yeah.
I mean, he was the best player in the playoffs for us.
We'll see. Yeah. All right, guys. We appreciate you tuning in, and we'll see you soon. Enjoy the off season.
Good night.